guests, even friends. We love the Besser family. Let's give them a big hand of appreciation. Oh, hallelujah! Hallelujah! This is wonderful! As I was sitting down there, I'm thinking.
That's dangerous.
And getting an impression to tell you this about what just happened.
Yeah, go ahead.
When you're in the atmosphere of Jesus Christ, what you gonna do when he comes for you? What you gonna do? You see, you can be seated right now. Check one, two.
Man, that sounds like woo!
Hallelujah! Praise God!
Maybe turn some of that down because I'm a loud preacher. Is that all right this morning?
But when the atmosphere has been stirred.
He wants the monitor stirred. Put the house on.
And he shows up.
Yes.
Every Sunday. He's saying, what you gonna do when I come for you? You see, when you get into the power times, because I call these end times the power times,
yes,
we got to know what to do with the anointing.
Yes. Yes.
And sometimes through a song or through a word, you just need to stop, drop, and roll. Because he wants to invade you,
yes,
but he's not living for a moment.
Yeah.
If you're living for a revival, it's too late.
Come on.
If you're living for a moment, oh man, I just didn't want to preach, but here I go. Preach it. If you're living only for a moment, or for when the good-looking preacher comes in and you want to get hands laid on, you're seriously mistaken this morning. The good looking part. But what he does want to do is he wants to let you know who you are in Christ. So when you leave on it, you can actually get it on your own during the week.
Oh man, that is so beautiful. It's dangerous. Brian's in the house. I'm just going to stay here.
But when the atmosphere has been created, and if you only come in and hog it, and you only come in and drink on it one time or another, and you keep going back to the same mentality, oh, well, I guess I'm sick this week too. I need to come on down and get a word. Well, then you're living in a defeated mentality. And I've come to shake up some demons in the building to say, you can be in Christ. In other words, I like to say in Christ. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're in Christ. And all that means is it's your identity of who you is. Turn to your neighbor and say, who is you? I believe that this church and this day and hour, the Holy Ghost has sent me not to just give you more information. Because information will only go so far. But I believe he's come today because there's those that are sick and tired of being sick and tired. Ken Bankston, who's been called of God as a pastor, a shepherd, someone that smells just like the sheep because he's in there with you. You don't get to blow in and blow out like Brian.
I get to leave here right now after this.
But there ain't nothing more on this man's heart than to know he's raising up a victorious, undefeated people. He loves you this morning. He wants you to begin to know what to do with the greatness. I'm sitting down here, man, and I'm like, I could come in right now, sing a couple, and we go home. We had church. If you didn't jump in the healing pile, or the, you know, whatever was going on here with all the, there was prophetic going, and it wasn't pathetic, it was good. And you know, the healings that go on, directional prayers go on. I know each one of them that were up here can say the same thing. We had church. Yeah. But what are we going to do with it when we leave?
Yeah.
Monday's coming.
Yeah.
Are you still healed on Monday?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Even if your body starts feeling, oh, man, that sciatic. Oh, that thing. Just bone spur in my big toe, that corn and bunion. Listen, it's the same healed as you got right here.
Yeah.
And said, thank you, Jesus, by your stripes I am healed.
Yeah.
2,000 years ago, you did it. And now I'm going to live victorious every day that ends in Y. Wow.
For those of you who don't know me, this is how I roll. I'm Brian Hesser. And I love your family. I like to say I'm crazy for Jesus. Amen. Radically saved.
Amen.
Radically on fire for Jesus.
Amen.
And I like that the inside stuff comes out. I want to get to know the real you. Who your identity is in.
I'm not going to preach my sermon. I'm going to sing to you right now.
How many of you know that God is the God of the impossible?
Yes.
He wants to move some mountains up in here. And he's going to use your mouth.
Yeah.
Hey, I didn't come all the way up here to try to get you hooked on Facebook with me and be my best friend. Listen, I didn't come here for that. I came to give you a word from God. Because he said it's time to start living victorious. Amen. Amen. It is just like the Lord to do a miracle for us.
Amen.
Listen to this new song.
Thank you. Denise, I just love you guys so much. I appreciate you.
And isn't it fun to be in the house of God?
Just gather,
rub shoulders, talk about it, talk about our things, talk about stuff. And I just heard about this, that the kids went to Tijuana. Come on. There's some tired parents. I'm not even going to go back to them. There's some tired parents, but I bet the kids are on fire for Jesus. You know, those trips will make a difference. When you start getting out of the box and traveling, I mean, Levi gets to see all sorts of different cultures and different things. So I pray whatever you got there, you continue to bring. All the parents that took him, thank God. So, this is Levi. He is my role dog. He is my partner. And I'm telling you, ready to go? Oh, he wants a kiss. I'm going to hand this right over to Levi. He's going to sing a song or two. Bless you, amen.
Thank you.
We have to get him out of the basement. People need to see Jesus. In us. Because he loves the world. That he gave his only son. Jesus Christ. Our Savior.
Evangelistically sought after area. And I fought them. world.
Yes.
Samaria, Judea. So you might have to get uncomfortable in your evangelistic functioning.
Yes.
He might want you to go on the other side of town. He might want you to go to Walmart instead of Target.
Come on.
Do you know that I go to the 99 cent store just to witness? That's where they're hurting. They're broke, busted, and disgusted. I love going to those places. I just started thrifting because I love going into the thrift stores and saying, ha ha, I'm here. Jesus is Lord. He's in you today. You might have to go somewhere else, and I wanted to just say thank you. Spend some time on giving you some exhortation on your prayers and on your financial blessing for this ministry. And we are going places. 2006. We started it off here last year in the Riot Revival. Our ministry has never been the same. So thank you. I appreciate each and every one of you. And as I was talking about earlier, we have to become so in tune with who we are, or like I like to say, who He is in Christ Jesus. What we identify ourselves with, who we hang around, what we're saying are all identification processes.
Yes.
We lean on culture. We lean on music. We lean on denomination. What race we are. What we drive. What side of town we live on. What careers we have. Everything is rolled up into our identification process. But when we understand one thing, that really none of that matters at the end of the day, that we are identified with Jesus Christ, and we are actually, listen to this, we're actually in Him.
Bring it.
Amen.
In Him.
Yeah.
What does in Him mean? That means, Christian, you're a lot closer to Him than you even think.
Yeah.
And I'm going to unbox some things this morning. To where it's going to go so deep into your spirit, there will be impartation of the Word of God, and it'll be mixed with the anointing to where you can begin to start seeing who you is.
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor and say, who is you? I mean, aren't you really glad that your identification is not like being a Raiders fan? One day you're winning, the next day you're not. On any given Sunday, you don't know what to do or if you're going to win or if you're not going to win. Now, come on, don't get mad at me. I see some of you looking at me. How about them Niners fans? Come on. Aren't you glad that it's not up, down, roller coaster Christianity? But there's hope and an identity that God has in you. Here's the definition of identity. Check this out. Who someone is. The name of a person. Aren't you glad our names are written in heaven?
Yes.
How about this? The qualities, the beliefs that make a particular person or group, listen, different from others. If you haven't already figured it out, this church is different. I'm talking to some of you ex-Catholics. Have you got ex-Catholics up here? That got filled with the Spirit? You know what they're talking about? You know what I'm saying? They're crazy up on the hill. That's just what we want them to think. Because they will run to the church when they need us.
Amen.
It's a sameness of essential or generic character in different instances. It's the very thing we believe, the very thing of our core, of our identification. The relation established with the person. The condition of being the same with something described or asserted. Your pastor does a great job every Sunday describing how Jesus is and how He loves you. But I'm here today to say that there's life after Jesus died. We give the cross all the credit. Thank God, I love the cross. I love the blood of Jesus. But we have been given dominion on it. I said the word dominion.
Yes.
Because Adam screwed up, but we got it back.
Yeah.
We got it back. And we have this thing right here. and point to your mouth, everybody, and say, we got a speaker.
Yes.
Turn to your neighbor and say, is your speaker wire connected? We need to start connecting the speaker wire. None of this would matter if it wasn't for this thing right here. We could have a great looking speaker that says Yamaha. We could have everything we want, but without the speaker, nothing can come out. God wants to put the word in your mind.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Wants to put it in you. And then when you start believing what you're reading, then you'll start speaking it. Amen.
Amen.
Moving right along. Hallelujah. So how could it be possible that Christians who are spirit-filled, tongue-talking, Holy Ghost rolling, praying every time the church is open, Sunday shouting hallelujah, how does that Christian become defeated? I've been there. I'm not standing up here saying I'm better than you this morning, but I want to say something this morning. We win.
Yeah.
And it is an attack on your identification. An attack. Listen, I got a wallet in here right now. I got cards in here. I've got my Visa debit card, all right? Right here. It's got my name. It's got a business name. It's got an expiration date. Some of your dates on your cards are expired. Got a number. It's got a little thing chipped down, these little chips. You know, they say, well, stick that thing in there. Well, that's scary. But I do it. It's got the name of the establishment. It's got things on the back, codes. It's got a, I noticed it's got a 1-800 number. And right next to it, it says, if lost, call. Probably the most important thing on the card is the lost number. What's been happening in the body of Christ is we're getting so revved up for a moment that we're not figuring out the lifestyle. And my question to you today is, you've been leaving your wallet laying around? Where's your wallet? Or better yet, what's in your wallet? Because Satan is out there to steal one thing. He could care less where you live, what you drive, all of your financial woes, and he don't care about none of that. But what he does care about is your identity in Christ. And if he can get you unchristed, unbelieving long enough, the drip system that he's been dripping on your life will steal you blind. Listen, if somebody got into that car, I got millions in this bank. If somebody got my car, they would have total access to my account. What is Satan accessing in your life? Don't lose the number on the back. And that comes in forms of the Word of God. If it means we got to come back to John 3:16, then by golly gee willikers, let's come back to it. For God so loved the world, that's all he knew, that he gave his only Son, and whosoever would believe on him should not perish, but have what? ID. The Holy Spirit is knocking on your window of your car this morning. And he's saying, I need to see your ID. Some of you are disqualifying yourself because you need to know who you are in Christ. Good preaching. And when a people gather in a building and they begin to stir themselves up in faith about who they are, that's when the revival happens. When they're awakened to the fact that I am in somebody, oh, come over here, or I am in Jesus, then I can have everything that Bible
will see.
Amen.
That's what he's been talking to me about.
Amen.
Who are you, Brian? Would the real you stand up? So many times we blame humbleness on saying wrong things. Well, Jesus just made me lower than dirt because I'm a humble man. Oh, I'm broke, busted, and disgusted because Jesus just gives that out. And I'm telling you what, I'm going to receive mine and do to know. Listen, you have received it already.
Yeah.
Have you been born again? Raise your hand. Jesus inside you. And we're not even talking about the other stuff like the Holy Ghost. Man, that's
dessert. That's it. Gotta keep moving, you guys.
So we've talked about identification. We talked about your wallet. Don't get it ripped off and keep the number. Don't let Satan steal it. Don't let him start thinking you're a part of something. You're a part of Jesus Christ. You are in him. And when you begin to speak those things, you will start having them. Amen. Now some of you might say, well, that's a name and claim it thing. Well, yeah. You confess the word, you start believing it, you start speaking it, and it happens. Amen. Do you believe that this morning?
Yes.
So the battle is the identification process, who we are. It cracks me up.
This doesn't happen a lot, but the other day I turned on daytime TV. That's disgusting stuff.
But I kind of got, you know, I was watching Maury, man. And I was just sitting there watching it a little bit. And I'm like, they're trying to find out paternity tests. Like, you know, whose baby's daddy? Whose baby's mama? And they get this whole thing, they're cashing in on this stuff. They got people tuning in. And I'm going, this is kind of interesting. They got the chairs set up. They create an atmosphere of questions. Who is, who's your daddy?
I don't know.
Turn to your neighbor and say, who's your daddy? They don't know who their daddy is. So they make a show about it. And then they find out after, listen to this, after the blood test comes in, they got the guy sitting up there in his chair, the host, Maury. He's got the results of who their daddy is. And the daddy is just kind of sitting over here going,
oh my God, I hope it's not him. Oh.
Very rarely do you get a dad over here going, I hope it's him.
I hope it's him. I hope it's my kid.
But no, you got the nervous dad going, oh. And so they're trying to figure this thing out. And just kind of, they send you to commercials every 2 minutes. They keep you coming back. So I'm going, I got to find out who this kid is. Is it his or is it not his? I'm just like, wow. See how you get sermon material?
Don't watch more. This is.
Okay, final commercial, it comes back and he's got this big envelope.
And he takes that big envelope and
he's like, still slagging, you know, he's like, come on.
He goes, whoosh.
Takes the envelope off, blows in it, you know, pulls it out, and he says, I have the results right now. Of who your kid's gonna be, or if he's not gonna be. Are you ready to find out who your daddy is? And the man over there's going, whoa, Jesus, I'm gonna get closer.
I don't know.
And so all of a sudden he reads, the results just came in, and it says that this kid is absolutely 100%
your kid.
And everybody goes, ooh, wow. I'm here to tell you today that by the blood of Jesus, your identity, your DNA is in him, and he knows. Like a bad habit, you know, and it's sad because there's a second part to that whole story. There's a kid over there somewhere. They never show the kid that's like, well, now I got a daddy. Some of you have a daddy. Some of you have a daddy, Jesus, and you know of him or about him. But today, he wants you to know who you are in him. And that comes with a relationship with your daddy. Amen. It's more to just know that you have a daddy, but it's better to know him. Amen.
Amen.
Knowing about and knowing. So God's heavenly blueprint that says we are in Christ and that he has come and sent a perfect human being in Jesus and that his shed blood was for you, transfused you. Turn to your neighbor and say transfused.
gives you a new identity. Here's a scripture all about it. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 19. It says this.
Therefore,
if any person is engrafted or in Christ, he is a what? An old wore out thing? He is a new creation. A new sort of creature. Do you know that I'm looking at creatures today? That's why I like to say, in other words, who are you? Who's the real you this morning? The old previous moral and spiritual condition has passed away. Aren't you glad this morning?
Yes.
Behold, listen to this, the fresh and new has come. But all things are from God. Who, listen to this, who through Jesus Christ reconciled us to himself, received us into favor, brought us into harmony with himself, and gave to us the ministry of reconciliation.
Yes.
That means when you find out that you're a new creature, somebody's going to look at you and go, wow, they're a little different. What is that new creature? Let me check this new creature. Who's the new creature? It'll make Avatar look horrible. You're a new creature. And when that happens, when we get the revelation of who we are in Christ, people will want to talk to you. They'll want to get in your way. Father God has given you a ministry of reconciling people back to favor. Amen?
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah. It's just going to get gooder. Say, turn your neighbor and say, it's gooder and gooder. That by word and deed we might aim to bring others into harmony with them. There was God personally present in Christ, reconciling and restoring the world to favor with himself. Not counting up and holding against men their trespasses, but canceling them and committing to us the message of reconciliation, of the restoration to favor. Aren't you glad for 2 Corinthians 5 to 17? That just lets us know there's just a little bit more to all we've ever been taught. That we can actually be in Christ, actually dwelling in him on a daily basis.
Yes.
I kind of look at it like this. Back in the bar days, you had to have an ID to get in. We found out all sorts of crazy ways we could get in underage. Try to fake the ID. Try to do this. But that ID would let you gain access to the environment that you wanted to go into. Well, it wasn't good, but we wanted to get in there. There was a hot band and there was some other stuff in there. And it gave us access to get in there and partake of whatever was going on in the village. Well, I think we make it too easy to come to church. I think Pastor Kim needs to stand back at the door. And before you're allowed to even get in the building, card you. How's your attitude today? How you been serving Jesus this week? Can I get in, Pastor? Can I get in? You talk about revival. Start making you get carded to come to church. A little too easy to sit there every Sunday going, oh, yeah, there's just another old boring sermon or whatever. There's another vile preacher coming in. Nothing happened, really. How about getting carded?
Yeah.
How's the attitude? What you do this week? Yeah, I'll let you in. Come on, we're ready for you. You can worship with us. That's holiness preaching right there. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You've got your grace and mercy so full, you don't know what to do with holiness.
Come on.
He wants you holy.
Yes.
He wants you proven. He wants you in him this morning.
Amen.
This is too tough for you. I apologize in advance, but I'd love you enough to tell you about it. A blood transfusion is when you take on new DNA. If you've lost any blood, you know that a natural blood transfusion has to take place. It comes into your circulatory intravenously. They stick you with a knife. Transfusions are used for medical conditions to replace lost components of the blood.
There's diseased Christians that have been talking wrong and doing wrong, and it's infected their whole body.
Come on.
Says in the wire, some of you are sick because of visiting.
It's right around when you take communion. I'll just let you know that.
In the very beginning of life, the blood that begins to flow in your body has a certain genetic marker. Or a strand of codes, you've seen them on paper, that will instantly identify who you are. The blood is where the life lives, amen? The blood is where the identification of you is. The blood is a very important aspect of your DNA or your genetic construction. Who you is.
Turn to your neighbor and say, who is you?
I'm going to show you how the blood of Jesus has marked you. Many times a doctor will do a blood test and just a very small prick on your finger, just a little prick on the finger, that little blood starts spouting up. He'll be able to tell you everything about you. If there's disease in your body, anybody ever had that happen? Raise your hand. Just a small piece of blood will give you the determination of who you are. What's going on in your body? The blood identifies your symptoms, and when disease hits your body, it will attack. The first part of the attack is your blood. I want to tell you this morning that matching blood is important. In the event you needed a rescue and there was something in your life that ascertained that you needed blood, you better make sure that that blood matches you when it goes in. Aren't you glad that you did? If you got sick and you needed blood, that they didn't give you baboon blood? Even though some of you act like it. Aren't you glad that you didn't get a cow or goat's blood or a dog's blood, but that they give you a matching blood sample? Many of you know in the cancer world out there that you have to have matching bone marrow, matching blood types. I'm here to tell you today that your blood, when you became born again, the DNA of God Almighty is flowing through your veins. Yeah. That you don't have to live for a moment of healing, but you can actually claim that healing for you.
That's right.
To start living Monday through Sunday victorious in Him.
Yes.
Don't let Satan steal it. Some of you are going, "Why, that's what you're saying? You say we got that much control down here?" I hate this when Christians say, "Whatever happens, happens. Okay, sirrah, sirrah." No! If you believe whatever happens, happens, that ain't right. We got a scripture for everything that happens in our lives. Amen? Don't have that attitude. Amen? I believe I'm talking to good people that know who they are in Christ. Amen? Somebody say amen this morning. You know who you are this morning. It's a process, too. I'm going to tell you, I'm a process in what I do. I've had to figure out who I am before I can go out and do more. I've been in some places like, "Oh God, I'm glad that's over. I didn't really know who I was. I was too busy worried about what I'm wearing. What's going on?" I don't care anymore. Because I know who I is. And when you start knowing who you is, you're going to get stronger. Amen? Here's a scripture in Philippians that says this. Who, although being essentially one with God in the form of God, possessing the fullness of the attributes which makes God God, did not think this equality with God was a thing that he eagerly grasped or retained. But Jesus stripped himself of all privileges and rightful dignity so as to assume the guise of a servant or a slave. We're talking about matching blood this morning. In that he became like men and was born a human being. God Almighty had to have a perfect match. So the thing of the cows and goats ended. Aren't you glad? Yeah. Aren't you glad you don't got to bring your first goat in every Sunday? Yeah. And slay it right here. And Pastor Kim's like, "I'm going to call the janitors again." Aren't you glad? But aren't you glad that God knew that the DNA was something important? That the very marker, the very thing that makes you who you are, was in His Son, yeah. Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Who had to die for you. This whole time, Jesus Christ knew. He knew he had to die. And he says, as soon as I'm slain, and when he said it was finished, it was finished. about the blood all the time. The blood, thank you for the cross. But really knowing about the DNA that runs through you. Who you are. There ain't a devil in hell, a drug on the planet, an addiction on the planet that can take that away from you. It's running through your body right now. And that right now. And that's why they call it the Holy Ghost in fire. Because not only were we buried with Christ, crucified with Christ, amen. Galatians says we were crucified. And then we have to have a proper burial, amen. Don't you think sometimes we just need to have a proper burial? We celebrate salvation all the time. Hallelujah. I think we should celebrate that person's funeral. Yeah. You're dead, dude. Let's celebrate and have a barbecue. You're done. Let's celebrate death. Too many Christians are hanging on to the old ways trying to get victorious.
Oh,
gosh.
It's funny, my mom, this telemarketer kept calling. Right at dinner time, 6 o'clock, they're sitting down eating their dinner religiously at 6. And this telemarketer called for 4 months. 4 months, she'd be eating, all of a sudden, here's this telemarketer coming on it. Well, what's going on? And I want to sell you this. And mom's nice that she's kind of hanging on. No, she finally started, I can't talk to you no more.
So finally, the Holy Spirit gave her an idea. This telemarketer kept asking for my dad.
I said, your husband there, I need to talk to your husband. I need to talk to him because I got to sell him this thing.
And so all of a sudden, my mom decides to say, one day, the father came in and the person says, yes, Sam Ezra, I need to talk to your husband. She says this. She said, the old man died. The old man's gone.
He didn't really die.
His old man died, and it worked. They stopped calling. They thought my dad died.
Half truth right there.
The old man died. Stop digging it up. We have to have a proper burial, amen? To really know who we are. And that life is a life of holiness, a life of being in there with God. It says this in Hebrews, because the blood of bulls and goats is powerless to take sins away.
Amen.
Aren't you glad that little scripture right there just says, listen, I'm gonna relay the message to you that it's okay not to believe in that goat and blood stuff, but believe in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So there has to be a match of blood. Ephesians 1 says this, even in his blood, he chose us. He chose us, hand-picked us. Turn your name and say, even hand-picked.
Hand-picked.
And then he picked us out for himself. As his own, in Christ. There's that word again, in Christ. Before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy. There it is. Man, why did they have to put that in there? Why? That we should be holy, consecrated, and set apart for him. You talk about revival when we set ourselves apart. And blameless. Are you kidding? In his sight, even above reproach, before him in love. For he, listen to this, foreordained us. That means he destined us, planned us into his future to be adopted and revealed as his own children in Jesus Christ. This is just straight scripture now, and you've got to be feeding on that. In accordance with the purpose of his will, because it pleased him and was his kind intent. Aren't you thankful for the love of God that sent his son to give us a genetic makeup and a sweet DNA? Let me tell you, baby, sweet DNA. Good genes. You know, hear that thing? What are you? You know, I got good genes. Man. You must be good genes in you. You know? We got Jesus Christ genes. Running through our blood and identifying ourselves with that blood. And knowing who we are and the authority that we have on planet Earth, there ain't nothing that Harvest Fellowship can't do.
Yes.
There ain't nothing this church in this church's future that Satan can hinder. When a people get together and know who they are and not always live in the defeated life, but actually really gaining and pressing in and going from glory to glory.
Yes.
And walking in his mighty power and presence. When we know who we are. There's marriages that suffer from identification process. You hear the term middle-aged crisis, midlife crisis. All attacks on identification. The strongest marriages are marriages when they know each other. When they get the revelation that the two have become one and they're becoming one, those marriages are strong. There's an attack on our identification process. Teenagers. Well, just look at a teenager's life. Trying to figure out who they is and who they're all about and what they're going to do and how do they look. Do I look good? We're in a generation of selfies, man. I'm getting tired of looking at all the selfies. I mean, I'm on there, but I mean, there's some people that go after it. It says in Timothy, we are in a self generation. That men will be lovers of what? Themselves. And you know, we're in that generation right now. So my heart goes out for teenagers. But I'll tell you what, this group up in here went down to Tijuana and they checked some things out and they began to see that there's hurting people. And they started getting a sense, I believe it this morning, that there's an identification that's starting to happen. There's a molding and a making because that identification is, well, there is more to life than Sonora. Or Sonora High, or these girls over here talking about me. Oh my gosh, identification. We're talking about who you are in Christ. We all go through it. And the more that we get into His Word, the more we study, the more we find out about Him, the more, I believe, the more power, the more revelation we'll have on how to react to different things. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. We've talked about we have the perfect match in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen?
And then the quality of blood is important too. So now we've got a good matchup, and now we need good quality blood. Before a blood transfusion is given, there are many steps to take to ensure the quality of the blood. The blood has to be free from disease and virus. Many, many tests are done to the blood before it can be transfused to the recipient. The blood has to be pure, organic, not synthetic or fake, or not of any animal. It says this in 2 Corinthians, "For our sake He made Christ virtually to be sin, who knew no sin." Don't you love that? "So that in and through Him, we might become viewed as being examples of the righteousness." What a tall order, but what an honor that He has entrusted us with this new identification. Doesn't this message want to make you live a little better?
Yes.
Make you know that there's something important about what He did on Calvary? I hope that's stirring in your hearts this morning. And to not to just live for a moment of anointing. There's so many things going on. Listen, I travel and I see it all. They come to me and think I'm that guy. So now what I'm doing is when people come up in prayer, and some of you this morning say, what scripture are you believing on? How long have you been believing for that? And what scriptures are you believing? A lady came up this morning for a healing. I asked her, what scripture? She said, "By Jesus' stripes, I am being healed." That's the first step to beginning to know who you are in Christ. When you open your mouth in His Word. Some of you are going through the motions. You look good doing it, but He just wants you to know He loves you. And you're in Him and He's in you. Amen.
Amen.
So listen, God gave His best blood, the spotless, sinless, pure, and holy sacrifice that would change everyone's DNA if they would just receive this life-giving transfusion. I just see a heavenly bag of blood that's just hooked up to our spirit, man. And some of us right now are getting the transfusion.
Amen.
Right now, there's some differences going on in your genetic makeup. That old man that's still kind of fighting who you are, that Jesus blood is getting in there. It's just pumping. It's pulsating to get you new blood, a new transfusion, to get it circulating, to exercise your faith daily. It gets your blood moving, doesn't it? Your blood is moving this morning. There's living power in the blood of Jesus, and that's been transfused into you.
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah. I think at the end of the day, isn't it all about just victory and who we are anyway? Not really, not even denomination, but that's important because we need coverings. But there's so many churches trying to identify with the new thing.
know, the just the different things, the lights, just this big worship moments. What makes a good worship series, man, is when the leaders, which they are awesome, when they come in with that heart of pure holiness, and they let you just go right in, and you enter into the garden. It's how they live, how a worshiper lives, how their lifestyle of worship is so important. And it's such an honor to be in a house where you come in and let you get that. You feel it, you sense the Spirit of God. So the first thing that was said today was what you're going to do with this anointing, what you're going to do with it, and then how we live in Christ, how we've been in Christ and through the blood of Jesus. Is there anybody today that you can honestly say, listen, preacher, I know you come in once in a while, but you just have never really understood the Christian walk. Like, I've said these things, I've even become a Christian, but it just seems like one thing after another. And listen, there's going to be attacks. Satan's after your identity, remember? He's after that law. He wants to strip you of who you are and what you're all about. That's why salvation is so important. But if you can honestly say, maybe this morning, you know what? I just need a transfusion. I've hemorrhaged myself almost to death trying to figure out the works of this Christianity. It could be anywhere from leadership to young people. And you're just hemorrhaging, and your blood is just escaping. But I'm here to say this morning that there is a heavenly blood bank that is connecting to your spirit, that wants to revitalize, re-give you your identity back. And in this identity, you will have the best days, the best future, Jeremiah 29:11, your best hope, your best expected end you'll ever have in your entire life. Am I talking to anybody this morning? When I say I go to Sonora to Harvest Fellowship, I think of people that know who they are. Not just living for a moment and it's over, but living a lifestyle of victory, hope, healthy, good blood. Turn your neighbor and say, good blood. Good blood. They got healthy blood there. They're circulating the community. There's blood flowing into that vein over there. There's out the riot center, come on, somebody. There's fresh blood in the riots. New kids coming in, knowing who they are. We got to make them walk and talk a little different than the other kids. That's the life-giving blood that's happening. And today, Father God talked to me about it. He said, they're hurting. Hemorrhaging. Some have been so in such a trauma, and you're about ready to just be so hurt over church.
Oh, Genesis, I know. Thank you, Lord.
Be strengthened, Father. He wants to pump back new blood. He wants to pump his DNA back in you. Revitalize, rejoin things together, supply you with what you need, and it's in the end. Let's say it together. It's in
him.
Let's say over here, it's in
him.
So today, my heart, the Holy Spirit, is working to get us back. I love that song, Heart of Worship. It's the very thing I was just, wow, man, I just set the whole thing up. Coming back to the heart of worship. Coming back, Jesus. To revitalize and regenerate my life. Jesus Christ was an incorruptible Son. And we are incorruptible. We have eternal life. If you got healed today, salvation's a bigger miracle. Because it's forever. And so as I believe right now, the Holy Spirit is speaking to someone. We don't need to use anything. We just need. Some of us need that. So I want you to be bold. I want you to stand up and come right up here. And this is if you don't even know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. You might not even know. This could be such a new thing. You're like, I haven't even gotten saved. Today's your day. Today is the day of salvation. And listen, we haven't even talked about the resurrection yet. This is the crucifixion and the burial, the death. There's a life with the power of God that we have that ID, That identification says, I got the power.
Woo.
I got the infilling of the Holy Ghost. And when we tap into our prayer language, when we tap into that Holy Ghost, that very DNA starts going out.
Amen.
This DNA needs to be passed on. Who's your daddy this morning? Jesus Christ. Amen. Who is it this morning? Just be bold to come on up, we'll pray with you, lay hands on you, and get this blood transfusion going.
Come on,
be obedient. We're all family here.
Come on.
Who you are in Christ, Jesus Christ. We all good? I'm going to hang out just for a second. Everybody say it, wiggle your fingers. It's called a wave. Are we good? Are we victorious this morning?
Amen.
I'm not trying to drum up an altar call, don't get me wrong, but there are some hurting people in the building. And it does have to do with who you are in Christ. You can get three good scriptures and just sling it in the giant's head. Pretty soon that thing just gonna bam right in that thing. It's gonna be over. Over. Amen? What do you want me to do, Holy Spirit?
Specifically, Father shared with me for this service, because we've been in prayer for hours and days and days and days for you. We don't come up to show up and ta-da. No. We take this very serious, the call of God that's on our life, and we're going to answer every word spoken. Father very specifically shared divine impartations and grace deposits to fall on you. Divine impartations and grace deposits. What that means is, Father supernaturally will impart into you what you need so you're not the same. That you won't leave the same that you came in Jesus' name. Scripture says, faith that cometh by hearing. You know, actually, if I could get Levi. I'm sorry, sister. But, yes, yes. Scripture says, faith that cometh hearing and hearing by the word of God. You've heard the word of God today, so your faith has increased. You've increased. It also says that the word of God does not return void, but it will accomplish that which is sent forth to do. It also says in scripture that I will perform my word. I will show you. Well, what did we just hear? We heard about being changed by knowing on purpose who we are in Christ Jesus. Who we are in Him will change you. You don't have to be the same. And you can receive this right where you're at. You've heard the word of God. Your faith has been increased. Divine impartations can come on you however you see fit for this to happen. But it's for you. And it's on purpose. Father wants you to know who you are on purpose in Christ. Who has been struggling with their identity? You know who you are. Get up here. Divine impartations and grace deposits. We're just going to have a little while to come up here that nobody else is going to come up.
Listen, we're not throwing stones this morning.
No, not at all.
You understand? We're not throwing stones. But there's a chance for you to change your whole being. Your whole DNA right now is on the line. Come on, I don't have to guilt you into this.
No.
You know who you are this morning. Come on up.
No.
Come on up.
This is supernatural. And this is all the glory and honor to God. Okay, nobody else come up. You're going to see a miracle.